Hello, welcome to Bite Size Med. This video is on excitation-contraction coupling in skeletal muscles. To understand this, you'll need to know a few things first, like the structure of a skeletal muscle and the sarcomere, the neuromuscular junction, how action potentials and graded potentials work. I will leave links to videos that I've got on this stuff in the description box below in case you need any of them. But to give this video a little orientation, I'm going to do a quick review of them. So the skeletal muscles are made up of fascicles, which are bundles of muscle fibers. The muscle fibers are basically muscle cells, and they have myofibrils. These myofibrils are made up of myofilaments. The myofilaments are thick and thin filaments which interdigitate. The thin filaments attach to the Z-discs, and the structure between two Z-discs is called a sarcomere. This is in the sarcoplasm of the muscle cell, which is a special name for the muscle cell cytoplasm. So it's got other stuff as well, like nuclei, mitochondria, and a specialized endoplasmic reticulum called a sarcoplasmic reticulum. This is special because it stores lots of calcium, and you'll see why that's important in a bit. The cell membrane of the muscle cell is called the sarcolemma. And at different points, this membrane dips down into the cell. In mammalian cells, this happens at the junction of the A and the I bands, so that's twice for every sarcomere. These are called T-tubules, or transverse tubules, because they are transverse with respect to the myofibrils. So the T-tubules open to the extracellular space. They are associated with the longitudinal sarcoplasmic reticulum on either side. Now these dilate to form terminal cisternae. So two of those, along with the T-tubule, form a triad. This is the sarcotubular system. All of this is inside the cell, and the muscle fiber is innervated by a motor neuron, the end of which forms a junction with it called the neuromuscular junction. It's at this junction that the nerve using a neurotransmitter starts off an action potential on the surface of the muscle membrane. Now the membrane is excited. This is going to result in a muscle contraction, and the process by which that happens is called excitation-contraction coupling. Now let's see how that happens. When the action potential starts on the muscle membrane, it gets propagated along the membrane. Now remember the T-tubules that dip down from the surface, it gets propagated along that membrane as well. This membrane has a calcium receptor called the dihydropyridine receptor. This is a voltage-sensitive calcium channel. So when the action potential depolarizes the membrane in this area, the channel will open. But rather than letting calcium ions in, it's more important here as a sensor. That's because this receptor is mechanically coupled with another channel on the terminal cistern. That's called the rhinodine receptor, which is a calcium release channel. So this channel opens as well, and once it opens, calcium ions leave the sarcoplasmic reticulum to enter the sarcoplasm, increasing the concentration of intracellular calcium. Now that calcium is going to bind to troponin C. Remember the thick and thin filaments? Myosin forms the thick filament, and actin forms the thin filament, along with tropomyosin, which covers the binding sites on actin, so that actin and myosin cannot bind. It also has troponins, troponin I, T, and C. I inhibits myosin and actin from interacting by binding to actin. T binds to tropomyosin, and C binds to calcium. If we assume this is actin with its binding site for myosin, and this is the head of myosin with a binding site for actin, tropomyosin covers the binding sites on actin. When calcium binds to troponin C, that creates a conformational change, moving tropomyosin out of the way so that actin and myosin can bind. That's the first step to creating a cross-bridge cycle. This cycle uses adenosine triphosphate, or ATP, for energy. We're going to be using these schematic thick and thin filaments. So the thin filament has got actin, tropomyosin, and troponins. The thick filaments have myosin with the tails towards the center and the heads angled outwards. Between the head and the tail is a hinge region for the myosin head to bend. And we're going to be using just one so that we can understand it. When calcium binds to troponin C, it moves tropomyosin out of the way, exposing the binding sites on actin. The head of myosin has an actin binding site, so let's start from when the myosin head is bound to actin. The myosin head also has an ATP binding site. When ATP binds, the affinity of myosin for actin comes down, so it detaches. By the ATPase enzyme, it gets broken down to ADP and an inorganic phosphate. They remain bound to the myosin head. ADP, that's adenosine diphosphate, increases the affinity of myosin for actin. So it extends and attaches to another monomer on the actin filament. With the release of the inorganic phosphate, the energy from that high phosphate bond is used to bend the myosin head at the hinge region. As it does so, it drags the actin filament along with it. This is called a power stroke, the bending of the myosin head. This is the sliding filament model, because the thin filaments are sliding over the thick filaments, and each time this happens, the thin filament slides inward. This is just one myosin molecule. There are lots of myosin molecules, and there are lots of sarcomeres at play. Each one needs one molecule of ATP, so it uses up a lot of ATP. Once the ADP is released from the myosin head, we're back at stage 1, where actin and myosin are bound until another molecule of ATP detaches them. And the cycle can repeat. Each time the cycle happens, myosin attaches to a new monomer on the actin filament. So it's like the myosin molecules are walking along the actin filament. This is the walk-along theory. With the inward sliding of the thin filaments, the length of the sarcomere reduces and the muscle contracts. Excitation got coupled with contraction. Now, as long as the calcium is high in the sarcoplasm, the contraction will continue. But without an action potential, the muscle will repolarize and the calcium release channel closes. There's also an ATPase pump on the sarcoplasmic reticulum, continuously removing calcium from the sarcoplasm back into the sarcoplasmic reticulum. This is the sarcoplasmic or endoplasmic reticulum calcium ATPase, CERCA. So the calcium levels inside the cell come down again unless there's another action potential. Repeated action potentials are thus needed for the contractions to continue without interruption. A lot of the calcium inside the sarcoplasmic reticulum is bound to calsequestrin, which is a calcium-binding protein. That keeps the bound calcium in the sarcoplasmic reticulum high compared to the free calcium. That reduces the work of the pump. So when the calcium level in the sarcoplasm comes down, the cross bridges stop forming and the muscle relaxes. When another action potential arrives, the process will repeat. And that is excitation-contraction coupling for skeletal muscle contraction. If this video helped you, you can give it a like and subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.